When you support your local PBS station, you help make programs like this one possible.
Get ready for Building Green, the show about creating gorgeous homes that are healthier, more energy efficient, and better for the environment. Today, we're building walls that breathe. It's time to unfortunately cover the interior of all of our straw bale walls with plaster. Like with the exterior, we're going as natural as possible using earthen plaster. Then we'll add a layer of gypsum plaster with natural colors to beautify the entire house. Where we can't plaster, we're going to paint with natural, low VOC paints that keep the air healthy. It's going to be fun today on Building Green. Kevin Contreras. It's great to have you back at Building Green. Our straw bale dream home is progressing very nicely. All of the straw bale walls are up and plaster on the outside, and today it's time to finish the interior walls. Previously on Building Green, we put up a steel post and beam structure for earthquake sturdiness and covered the building with a metal roof to keep our straw bales dry during construction. We then infilled all the exterior walls with straw bales. Those bales are made of rice stems and will act as structure and insulation as one. Not only will these bales keep the house well insulated, they will create a beauty and feeling like no other wall system does. In the end, our walls will be close to 30 inches thick and create a cozy, contained feeling. We decided to build with straw for several reasons. It's a very healthy, renewable, natural product that's typically a waste material. It grows in a single season and is often burned after the grain is removed. We built a greener concrete foundation by adding fly ash to the mixture. Laid out 2x6s with a channel of gravel to protect the bales from any water, and started stacking. We put the bales up like a brick mason would if he was using 90-pound bricks. It's called a running bond pattern, where the bales are staggered to provide strength. We impaled the straw bales with bamboo stakes to keep the walls sturdy during construction, and cut bales where necessary. To protect our steel from any condensation, we made a mixture of shredded straw and mud called chink, and used a similar mixture to pack every empty space to eliminate any thermal break in the home's exterior envelope. In the last show, we covered all the exterior walls and all those straw bales with earth and plaster, a mixture that is low in embodied energy, maintains health, and is dirt cheap. Earth and plaster, as it is called, is a mud and straw mixture that's an excellent material for covering straw bale walls. Then we added a couple coats of lime plaster to make the skin of our house durable and beautiful. We integrated pigment into the plaster so we would not have to paint the house now or ever, like classic homes of Europe. As the house ages, it will get more interesting, and if it ever cracks, we'll add more colored lime. We also poured windowsills with a limestone mixture to beautifully accent the windows and keep water off our straw bales. It perfectly filled the spaces underneath all the windows to protect the bales beneath and beautify. Today's challenge is to cover our interior walls with the healthiest products possible. Where we paint, we want to find a natural, no or low VOC paint that won't outgas harmful fumes. Where we plaster, we need to find a product that will work with our exterior earthen and lime plaster to create a wall system that is completely breathable. So today we're talking plasters, the skin of the building. Our straw bale walls are our exterior envelope of the building, but on that we have to put a skin. Traditionally, people have used cement plaster, but the plaster of choice these days is earthen plaster. This happens to be an earthen plaster. It is a clay that we got out of a local riverbed, and it's mixed with sand, ground straw, and water. It happens to have a great consistency, very sticky as you can see. The whole idea of this plaster is that unlike cement, it's very permeable. Gas, water can exit through the walls so that the wall stays nice and dry and we don't have any condensation or mold occurring in the wall. Our health expert Alyssa Alvord knows all about straw bale walls.
Straw bale walls are breathable. Water vapor can move in and out of the walls, so we really reduce our chances of having mold in the house. Water doesn't condense on interior surfaces because it has a chance to dry out. And so we don't create a mold breeding ground within these walls. Modern building systems have created very tight structures, and we want everything to be energy efficient and airtight. However, that's not the best thing really for human health.
So I found Michael, who's the chief man in charge, and in charge of everything. I gotta help you out here a little bit. You got a little bit of mud here. We're gonna put you on camera. We gotta clean you up a little. As you can see, he's been doing a lot of plastering today. We're here talking about what we've done for this skin of the building, inside and out. Explain to us what all is going on here and how all this is working.
Okay, Kevin. So what we've done is, after we've got our lath up, our wire, we're going to clad the bales in clay. It's a mixture of sand, clay, and straw. And the first coat we're going to put on is going to be the scratch coat. Before applying the scratch coat, we'll moisten the bales with a lime wash to protect it, and also to give more adhesion so we can key in the scratch coat. It's very important to have the scratch coat bind to the straw as well as to the wire.
It's not actually necessary, or even the code, to have this wire, correct? We could just put the plaster directly onto the straw.
That's correct. We've opted to do a stressed skin panel where we actually gain some shear value out of using the wire. Mm-hmm. And I feel a little bit more confident that it's gonna minimize the cracking around the windows and the doors.
Right.
So we kind of hedged our bets there.
So why are we using the earthen plaster?
This is a very, very simple, tried and true way of plastering a building. It's inexpensive.
Right.
I think most important for you is the fact that you are maintaining this breathability in your structure. As we know, there aren't any vapor barriers anywhere.
Right.
Once you put cement on anything, you reduce the permeability rate down to about 7. Using the earthen plaster, we're able to have a permeability rate of 27 and above. Perm rate is the exchange of vapors per hour through the walls.
Right. So essentially, we're creating a situation where gas vapor can leave the building, correct, and go on out, especially leave the straw. We don't ever want water condensing in that straw and making it moist.
The clay will actually wick moisture towards the outside of the building. We're also using a hydraulic lime finish. On top of the scratch, we'll put another brown coat. We're going to try and get the walls as smooth as possible for you. So we'll build it out with as much clay as it meets your specification. And then we'll proceed to put the hydraulic lime finish on it. That is a protectant, as well as a further way to draw moisture out. Drying becomes problematic because it takes quite a lot longer than using a cement product. So we'll get some heaters in on the interior.
We have a lot of places in the house where these interior walls that have been blue boarded to accept plaster are meeting bale walls.
That's correct.
So we either have to make the blue board walls move a lot to match the bales, or vice versa.
That's correct, and each one of these junctions is a great potential for cracking. So we're going to have to bridge this with diamond lath expanded metal, which will act as a bond between the earth and the plasterboard. So we're going to have to build this out with some lightweight gypsolite products, some gypsum, to get the same plane.
Okay, let's be really specific about how our straw bale walls are constructed and plastered. You can see by this cross section how all of the pieces go together. The straw bales are at the core of the wall. Then we have 2-inch wire attached from the 2x6s on the floors to the beam above and secured through the wall to each other with ceiling suspension wire. We put on 2 layers of earthen plaster and get each to progressively plane out the irregular bales. Just as we put a layer of lime plaster on the outside, we will add a layer of gypsum plaster on the inside. These layers will be added to the earthen plaster to create a skin about 2 inches thick to protect the straw bales and add to the thermal qualities of the wall. Before applying the earthen plaster, we trim bales as necessary to get flat planes. The desire is to make the walls as flat as possible to keep from having to add too much plaster in any one place. Generally, bale walls are left wavy, but we want ours quite flat. We trim the walls with a weed trimmer, and then we use a blade called a Lancelot blade on a 4-inch grinder. This wheel has chainsaw teeth on it and cuts bales cleanly and accurately. It's perfect for sculpting this window seat. When we're talking earth and plasters, we're talking saving green. Earth and plasters are dirt cheap. We bought our clay for $10 a ton. After purchase of the sand and transportation of both things, plus water and straw left over from building the walls, all of our earth and plaster materials will cost us less than $500 for the entire house. While a couple of the guys mix, Michael and the rest of our plasterers apply the mud. It's strange to be putting such a low-tech material on our walls when we've been accustomed to thinking that complicated, man-made materials must be best. It's a simple procedure of spraying the bales with a lime and water solution and applying the earthen plaster. We have professionals doing it, but almost anybody could apply it by hand or trowel. It takes more expertise around windows, doors, and window seats. We could simply leave our interior walls finished in this earthen plaster, but we want something more finished. So we're using gypsum to finish the interior wall surfaces. Now, if we really wanted to save green, we could stop right here. Many straw bale houses are finished in earthen plaster. The interior walls are left natural in earthen color. A finish can be added in the form of lime wash to give the walls beautiful color and durability without bringing in toxic paints or spending much on materials. When our walls are planed out and even, we start to apply the gypsum plaster. Perlited pre-mixed gypsum plaster is a lightweight plaster that is 50% lighter than most conventional plasters. It also offers much higher fire resistance as well as higher thermal and acoustical insulation values. This plaster has excellent wet cohesion, bonding capabilities, and coverage. It is suitable for either hand or machine application and requires only the addition of water at the job site. At $16 per 80-pound bag, it is cost-effective as well. Over the earthen plaster, we found that each bag covers about 5 square meters, costing us about 36 cents per square foot with delivery charges. The gypsum is mixed with water and natural pigment to create our integral color. These pigments are natural water and oil-soluble powders made from rocks, minerals, and earth. We've chosen to go with a neutral color that will let all our art pieces and furniture take center stage. It's possible to get almost any color you desire. Check with your local green building supplier to make sure you're getting natural pigments only, with no toxic chemical formulations. Our foreman, Michael Gordon, is overseeing the plaster job. He has a non-toxic bonding agent that is pink in color applied between the gypsum layers.
And as you can see, the process in the interior is a little bit different than over the bales. We've used a thin wall process on the inside, which is a plasterboard with a thin coat of Unical. Now, Unical is a gypsum-based plaster. Now that'll go over all of the blue board as well as our bale walls. We'll have to treat our bale walls with another gypsum product, gypsolite, to bring them out and to give it some suction for the Unical to bind to. And you're gonna get a very, very nice smooth plaster finish with this. So using the gypsolite over our interior bale walls that have the earthen plaster first coats, we're building it out, trying to straighten them up with the earth, and then we'll come back with the gypsolite.
The guys are masters at applying plaster. It's not an easy job, but they make it look simple. It's great to see the final coats going onto the walls. Well, not all of our house is made of straw bales. Our garage and laundry room are framed traditionally and have drywall on them. That means we'll have to paint them. Every home building show tells you about color, texture, but none of them tell you that the paint you're using is most likely dangerous for your health and for the planet. So when we want to paint, we can't just pop down to the local store to buy the color that looks best. We have to give some thought as to whether it is healthy for the planet and healthy for our families. Alyssa Oliver knows all about paints.
VOCs. It stands for volatile organic compounds. Now, the trouble with these compounds is that they are toxic formulations that emit into the indoor environment up to 3.5 years from the time that they have been painted. From regular gypsum board or regular drywall, it can take a very long time. So those 3.5 years, you and your family and your animals are breathing in these toxic fumes that are known to cause a myriad of health problems. They're known to cause insomnia, learning disorders, depression, anxiety, And the usual that we all experience when we walk into a room that's just been painted, dizziness, headaches, just kind of feeling lethargic. Fortunately, there are non-toxic alternatives that are now on the market. But virtually every paint company has come out with a low odor or zero VOC paint these days. And so with all of this, it is buyer beware. Most of these products still emit hazardous chemicals. They just aren't government regulated under the label VOC. Chemicals like formaldehyde, acetone, ammonia, these are compounds that are in a lot of these paints. So your best bet to find a good non-toxic paint is to go to a green building supply where you can get the real scoop.
So I'm here in Berkeley, California, in Eco Home Improvement to talk to Taja DeLeonardi about all kinds of things we can put in our house. But we're really here to talk about paint. They've got a paint bar here where we can discuss paint, find out what's safest and healthiest, and even mix the color that's right for us. We're going to have to paint some of our interior of our house. What are the options? Tell us about that. I know it's a big thing and it's something everybody does. Mm-hmm. So what are the green alternatives?
We generally consider as a green paint is one that is zero VOC. Mm-hmm. That stands for volatile organic compounds.
Right.
And we also really support the independent third-party certification system for paint that would be a Green Seal approved certification.
Right. And Green Seal really is important with regard to paints, aren't they?
It is, for a couple of reasons. One, it looks at the manufacturing of the product. Two, it looks at the durability. There are many things that are in a bucket of paint to help it perform, help it to last over time, for scrubability, for durability. Mm. There are many products that need to be there and that don't need to be there. Mm. The ones that don't need to be there but they still add as a filler are what you really want to avoid because they're really unnecessary, such as ethylene, chloride, formaldehyde. In fact, you have a list here of the different products, and so many of them, 1,2-dichlorobenzene, methyl ethylene ketone. How about that one?
Dinoctophthalate.
Phthalates, yes.
Phthalates.
Yes, these are products that we definitely don't want in the paint that we put in our home. So looking for the Green Seal approval really does assure.
Now, I guess I always assume that manufacturers put these things in these products. One, to make them more durable, possibly to make them cheaper. Why have they gotten so dangerous for us?
There's several reasons. You hit on two of them. I would also add that paint has been largely a professional installed product, where a painter would go in, paint, and leave. The quicker that paint dries, the sooner they are on to the next job, the sooner they're putting that second coat and then on to the next job. So that's why they would put chemicals in the paint that combust at low temperature, because that means is by the time they get to the end of the wall, it's already dried at the beginning of the wall.
The question everybody's going to have is how much more it's going to cost me to paint my house with something healthy.
In the lineup of green building products, paint is really one of those success stories. Mm-hmm. Not only is it affordable, it's easy to access and it's easy to use. So what is affordable? Well, we look at affordability. We look at, with paint, somewhere in the neighborhood between $30 and $40 a gallon for a zero VOC and mm-hmm. Green Seal approved paint. Certainly, there are paints that are much less, and we can even find paints that are even higher priced that are conventional in nature. Once you look at how many gallons of paint you need to paint an entire house, which is somewhere in the neighborhood of 20 to 30 gallons of paint, and if this paint is only $5 more, we're talking about $200 to $300 more to put the right product in your home that's safe for you and your family. So, Kevin, this is where we get to have fun.
Well, I thought I was going to get a pint of lager.
On the rocks?
On the rocks. Some lager. I got to have paint.
Well, we can actually make paint that has the color of lager.
Oh.
Light amber, a dark amber, a dark color. So this is
very
actually
nice.
Where we get to look at what colors mean to us and what colors that we like and actually pick something to put on the wall and create a whole new space.
This is great.
So this is for your garage.
Well, we've got a garage and we've got the laundry room, mm-hmm. a bathroom, and a pantry mm-hmm. that are all in the same area mm-hmm. that are not straw bales, so we're not plastering them. We need to paint them. And I want to do it in the best way possible.
Great. Is this a high active place where you're going to do a lot of projecting, carrying things in and out?
No, not really. I mean, the thing that's going to get the most action is the laundry room. Mm-hmm.
not so it doesn't, but it doesn't really matter that much. But so it doesn't have to be something that's super durable.
Most paints have a flat satin or a semi-gloss sheen, mm-hmm. where the cleanability increases as you go down to semi-gloss. This has the highest cleanability.
Right.
So I think for your room, we might want to stick with something in either the satin or the semi-gloss. Higher use, greater uh-huh. cleanability, and that matters because it does slightly affect the color. Do you notice there the flat has less coloration than the semi-gloss?
I do
see
that.
This is all the very same color, and what we're seeing is how light reflects off.
It seems to me that flat must be better environmentally. Is that true or not?
It would be true if the paint had different ranges of VOC as they moved along the sheen, mm-hmm. but the paint that we have is zero VOC across all sheens. And in terms of a color, now what are you doing in these
rooms?
Well,
what we're doing is we're doing all sort of natural mm-hmm. natural colors. The straw bale walls interior are going to be a gypsum with a bit of a color,
okay.
and we're doing basically drywall color. You know, it's a little bit brown, it's mm-hmm. a little bit gray, mm-hmm. and I think in this other area I'd like to do something like that, I think would be nice.
And this is exactly why I brought this color over. I thought this would be a real nice, balanced, subdued color to mm-hmm. have for a room that isn't necessarily going to be a living space, it's going to be an action space. It's a through-flow space, a place
right.
where you're going to be doing projects, folding laundry, doing some stuff in your garage.
Can we possibly mix me a little bit of paint so that we can go and try?
And I think what we chose was YOLO's Grain 2.
Well, and then we paint. This paint that we got is going on just beautifully and has absolutely no smell to it. In no time, it's going to make these walls look great. We need to talk stains. These antique doors that we're putting throughout the house need to have some stain to be beautified and protected. Regular stains can be smelly as well as very dangerous.
Typical wood stains that you see in a home improvement store are full of all sorts of indoor air contaminants. So sometimes they'll give you a beautiful finish, but they are polluting your environment. So what we see more of now are water-based stains that don't have those contaminants and oil-based stains that don't have those contaminants. The oil-based stains typically contain safflower oil, China wood, sunflower, hemp oil, and linseed oil. Linseed, great for water resistance. So we end up with these high quality stains that either come in wood grain colors all the way to bright purples and blues. Anything you could think of now is available in a non-toxic alternative.
Today's easy step is about your health. Nothing spruces up a room like a fresh coat of paint, but we have to be really careful about what paints we use and how we dispose of what's left. I don't know of any house that doesn't have at least a few cans of half-empty paint lying around. We always think that we're going to use that can of mauve that Aunt Betty gave us. What we don't realize is that paint doesn't last forever. The chemicals separate and make the paint unusable and even more toxic. But wait, don't just head out to the garage and grab those cans of paint and throw them in the trash. In Santa Barbara, we have a hazardous waste collection center that takes leftover paint and other toxic chemicals off our hands to recycle or dispose of them properly. So how did we do? Our interior plaster turned out better than I even thought it would. It's really durable and inexpensive and soft to the touch. More importantly, it's permeable, so our straw bale walls can breathe and maintain healthy indoor air quality. We also protected our health and the health of the planet by using healthy paints and stains. Well, our surfaces are done and it's time to start filling the house. Next week, it will be time to start doing some of the interior finishes that will make our house comfortable. We'll finish our cement floor with natural, non-toxic stains and finishes to create beautiful floors that will hold rugs, furnishings, and people. Then we'll go upstairs to finish our wood floors in the healthiest way possible that brings out the beauty of our recycled sheep barn floors. We also use the leftover flooring to make some great shoe racks, and we'll show you how to create inexpensive closets that are healthy, beautiful, and unique. Join us next time on Building Green. For in-depth information on today's show and to learn more about all aspects of green building,
Join us on our website at buildinggreentv.com. That's buildinggreentv, as in television, .com. See you next time on Building Green.